Vance Powell is a Grammy-winning producer and engineer with credits ranging from The White Stripes and The Dead Weather to Chris Stapleton and Beck. We headed to his studio in Nashville to find out how he creates an impactful mix by deconstructing a track from rock four-piece Tyler Bryant and The Shakedown. Over the course of this in-depth video tutorial, Vance explains his decisive production approach and demonstrates the recording and mixing techniques employed to create a hard-hitting sound.
Hello, my name is Vance Powell and I'm here in Nashville, Tennessee at Sputnik Sound. I'm going to be sort of deconstructing some recording and mixing techniques for a record by an artist by the name of Tyler Bryant and The Shakedown. I did the record here last year and it's starting to do really well and very excited about it. And this song, it was the first single here in America. It's called Loaded Dice and Buried Money. And we set out on this to make a tougher sounding record than the record that Tyler had made before, which really was more of a bluesy, more blues-based sort of record. And I think we accomplished that. I think we did it. To get a bigger sound for this record, first thing is we recorded everything live in one room. I know that's a crazy concept, but it actually works, kids. We put the drum kit in the spot in the room that sounded best, and then we lined the guitar and bass amps up along the front edge of the kick drum. It's an old Glenn Johns trick. I wish I came up with it, but I didn't. It's his. It works really great. A little some thin foam gobos, not really thin, maybe, you know, like 2-inch foam gobos between the drums, on either side of the drums, and then on either side of the guitar amp or bass amp. So it was drums, bass amp, guitar amp, and then on the other side of drums, guitar amp. And lined all the microphones up. I recorded room mics in stereo in the back of the room. And that image of the guitars, you know, Tyler's guitar to the left, Graham's guitar to the right, drums in the middle, obviously, was the basis of the whole record. So it's the record was cut live. And it was cut without headphones. So I wanted the band to play together because they're very well rehearsed. So we basically just sort of worked on levels to get the levels right in the track. And I can play those tracks if you'd like, just the basic track. And this would be the tracking guitars. We didn't overdub them. Two tracking guitars, tracking bass, and tracking drums. So that sounded like this, I believe. Now, if I deconstruct this a little bit, I can show you that there's drums. And you can hear a little bit of the guitars in the room. Bass guitar, a lot of distortion going on there. And then Tyler's guitar. And then Graham's guitar. And these two tracks, I put different EQ points basically when we were cutting the guitars so that the two of them in mono would sound like one guitar. But then when split apart, definitely become two guitars. So this is just the tracks, basic tracks. And if you look on my session, you'll see that on the session, there's really no edits. The reason for that being is the band plays really well, the drummer's really great, and I just didn't feel like it needed editing. It did play to a click, and it was a great take. I think this, looking at the time code, is starting at about 3 hours and 30 minutes or something like that. Somewhere along there. And so, you know, we worked on this song for about 3 hours. I just hit record, we just let it record. And this was take 17, I see on my screen. So to get the signature guitar sound at the beginning of the song, Both guitar players, Tyler and Graham, were playing baritone guitars. So it's tuned down, it's in baritone tuning. And then that went into the smallest amp I could possibly find in the building, which was an Epiphone Valve Junior. It's like 4 watts, it's an 8-inch speaker, and it's just wide open. The great thing is it's not very loud, so it's not like it's going to have a lot of bleed or anything like that. And then on this song, I believe that Graham was playing a Three Monkeys amp, which is a custom amp that was designed for him through a 212 cabinet. I'm not exactly sure, I'd have to ask him. But basically, they're both playing baritone guitars. So that's part of the reason why the guitar sound is so low. So if I solo up Tyler's guitar here, you can hear it. By the way, what I'm playing back, this is a flat on the channel. Let me switch to the mix window here. Tyler's guitar are these two guitars right there. You can see it's flat. The faders are all at zero. There's no plugins on the guitar, and there's no plugins or EQ on the desk. No compressors, no any of that stuff. So, and it's hard panned, obviously. There's two microphones. One is a Sony C48 condenser, and the other is an SM57. And I bring those into a pair of old RCA BA11 old RCA BA11 mic pre's from the 50s. Pretty great. And then Graham's sound here, he comes in a couple seconds later, is this. And I actually put a little bit of EQ on the desk here just to kind of match the mix, but here's without the EQ. Still pretty good sound. But I just want a little more, maybe just a little more bite. There's a little bit more EQ, a little bit of EQ on the desk. And then the other important thing to know is that the bass. Noah Denny is the bass player, and he plays short scale bass. And we're going to a Fender Bassman. He's sending me a direct signal straight out of the bass, and we're miking my Bassman, which is in full distortion mode. So I can show you what the bass sounds like here. All right, there's two channels here of bass. One's DI, which is this. It's flat wound strings, really dark, kind of muddy. And then the fuzz bass, this is an amp. If we look on our session, you'll see that in the session I'm using the Little Labs IBP to get the timing just right. A UAD, that's a UAD plugin, a UAD Fairchild, put a little bit of compression on it, and then an EQP1A to get just that low, super low, cool, fat bass. And that's it. That's it. Nothing else on the desk, no EQ, just kick ass. And then basically the drums. Let's talk about the drums. The drums are my Leedy drum kit. It's a 1947 Gold Sparkle Leedy drum kit. It's a 24-inch kick drum. It's just pretty much kind of a standard old 1947 drum kit. There are, if you can look on the session here, on the tracks, I think maybe, I don't know, 10 tracks of drums. I think it's 10. Two room mics, one kick drum channel, one snare drum channel, a rack tom, a floor tom, or floor tom, rack tom, two overheads, and then a couple of channels that are sort of special to me, things that I do. So let me just solo the drums, because the drums are pretty awesome on this track. It's a really great track. Caleb Crosby is the drummer. He's really great. Hold on, let me put our groups together here. All right, so this would be just the drum kit. I'm going to solo in Pro Tools. You can see there's a couple of EQs. Well, I'll show you those in a minute. But the faders are flat, and the faders are flat. Everything's flat on the console. So this is as I recorded it. You can hear the guitars in the room. That's by design. All right, cool. So if you're looking at the session, you're going to see room left, room right. That's these two tracks. And then kick, snare. So there's a couple tracks here I want to show you. One of them that's a special one is called Sprinkle to Taste, or The Taste, as we often. This is a old Ampex mic that comes into my desk. It goes through a DI. It comes into my desk and goes through some pedals. I'm doing a little bit of distortion and a little bit of actual of analog delay in a pedal. And I'm trying to sort of get a sort of like sort of a triplet feel. It's that same feel that everybody goes on and on about in When the Levee Breaks, the echo. That was a tape echo. This is just an analog echo. So this is just that track. Hopefully you guys get this. Of course, it's a ways out here. Here it comes. It's exactly the When the Levee Breaks thing. I'm just cheating and sort of doing it. Timed the echo while he was playing drums. It's not a lot to tinkle. It's an analog. It's a pedal. It's back here behind me on this wall. There's another track right next to it. You'll see that says Distorted Kit. That is something that I only used on this track. I only used it on this. I thought I'd try it, and it worked out pretty good. And it is just the whole drum kit basically put through a distortion box and blended in with it. So this will be the Taste and the Distorted Kit. Pretty cool. I could just record a whole record of drums like that, to be honest with you. Okay, then there's a couple more. One of them is mono, you'll see here, vocal room. This is a scratch vocal track, and this is a microphone plugged into a guitar amp in another room that's just distorted so that I can hear Tyler singing or talking. It just is really crappy sounding, but I thought it sounded kind of cool when I blended it in. Yeah, pretty awesome. And then there's this last one, and that's mono kit. Now, this is something I did on my desk. This is a bus from when we were tracking drums. It's the kick drum, snare drum, and toms bust out to an 1176 compressor and then printed back into Pro Tools. It has no cymbals in it. It's just a mono drum kit compressed, and this is it. Want to hear that a little better. All right, cool. So now if I take the original drums, I'm just going to turn on my special tracks, which this encompasses two channels of the board. I'm just going to play those. This is the Taste, or Sprinkle to Taste, I call it, Distorted Kit, the room mic, a vocal, scratch vocal mic, and the mono kit. Okay, pretty cool, right? I think. And then I'm going to play just the drums here. Same exact track. And I'm just going to add these other tracks in one at a time. There's the Taste. There's the Distorted Kit. There's the room. And there's the mono. Pretty cool, huh? I think it's cool. And that's basically it. These tracks, I like to record these tracks this way. In other words, these are the like it's playing back off tape. I don't put a bunch of plugins on. I don't like to do that. When I was mixing this track, I found that a little bit of EQ in the room, this is the room EQ, this helped because the bass is in the room. A little bit of EQ, and one side of the room had a little different curve than the other because of the guitar amp. There's a little bit of EQ on the kick drum. You know, sometimes when recording a big kick drum, I just want it to be a little bigger. And then I stuck a transient designer on the kick drum just to give it that crazy knock. And then the only other plug-in on the whole drum kit is on the distorted drum kit, this 1176. And that's kind of just to control the distortion track a little bit. So that's it. When I track this record, we had the faders. These faders were the send to tape here on the desk, and then the upper faders were the monitor returns. And I just had them set flat, and never touched them. And I set Pro Tools flat and never touched it. And then just adjusted the gain on the main faders to dry the tape. This is just old school recording, and it made it so that the rough mix, I don't know, you know, the camera hill should show it, but you can see the rough mix. I mean, these faders are pretty much, they're pretty much flat. These are my group faders in the middle. I've got them down a little bit just to change the gain structure a little bit, but basically it's kind of just flat. And this is how we recorded it. We tried our best to record it this way so that way it was easy to mix. This record, like a lot of records, didn't have a big budget. So we had a lot of recording to do, and we didn't have a lot of time or money to do it. So we tracked two, sometimes three of these songs a day. And I think we cut all 12 songs in about 6 or 7 days. And then we did overdubs, half a day per song for the overdubs. So a lot of these overdubs were very well, we planned them out. They're like, okay, there's a part here. I hear like this Moog part that happens here. Let's do that. And we just left everything set up, basically. We did that. We did all the guitars in here. So Tyler and Graham both were in here. We had keyboard rig in here, everything in the control room, amps in the tracking room. And it just worked great. I can talk to people, look at the band, you know, we can talk, and it worked really great. So that's kind of the way I like to record. Again, not a lot of plugins. Try to get the sounds going in as much we can until you go to mix, and then sometimes you throw some stuff on. So a couple of other things here is when you have a guitar, two guitar band, I'm a big fan of guitar players living in their world. In other words, you know, Tyler lives in the left side to me. Graham lives in the right side. When I go see the band play live, they're actually backwards, which is kind of weird, although Tyler's in the middle. But I like putting sort of the main guitar, one left and one right, and leading them that way through the whole track. So all of these guitars are hard panned. They're all hard panned. Now, any sounds that we came up with afterwards, so like a perfect example of that would be, there's an intro guitar. This was a sound that we had multiple channels on the desk. This was Tyler playing this. We had multiple channels on the desk. And then I was using the desk and my outboard effects to basically print this sound. So this is basically a sound that we printed this way to be this way. And there's some tape echoes, full tone tape echoes I use. I have a pair of them. You can actually probably kind of hear them maybe a little bit back there. Two full tone tube tape echoes. And then I have a plate, and we have a couple spring reverbs that we use, master room and some other stuff. And those are all on the desk. So I can just turn a knob, bring them up, bring them into the guitar sound, and then just cut it. So there's a little intro and a bridge guitar sound here, and this is basically a good example of that. Okay, cool. So in the track, that sounds like this. So those sounds are obviously, we printed them. There's no need to add any effects. There's no need to do anything. Maybe a little EQ to make it fit into the mix. And probably I would do that on the desk. For the vocals on this record, this track is the RCA 77. But there's also another mic on it. And that is this little weird Ampex mic going down to an amplifier that's made here up in Illinois, a company called Analog Outfitters. They have a pair of amps called a Sarge and a Super Sarge. And I take the Super Sarge, I run this Ampex mic into it, and then I put it right above or right next to the RCA 77. So if, you know, here's the 77, here's the Ampex, they're right next to each other. And so he's singing, they're both in time, you know, they should be really close in time. That mic goes straight into this amp, and then the amp, instead of driving a speaker, it drives a hot plate. And then that goes to a DI, basically. And I blend those two together to get sort of a clean ribbon mic, you know, or SM7, one of the two, either one, I've used both. Depends on the vocalist. This one, this song is the ribbon mic, it sounded great. And then it adds just a little bit of distortion, because I have that amp pretty distorted. It adds a little bit of harmonic character to it. So let me just play a little bit of the vocal here. Tyler will hate me for this. I'm sorry, Tyler. But this is the vocal, and then there's a double that goes along with it.
She'll dig, dig just a little bit deeper. She's a shake-up snake I'd play for keeper.
Cool. So... So we record this, and that's cool, and edit it and comp it and all that. And when I go to mix it, I have a little vocal chain. I'll be happy to pass along to everybody, because I don't really care about all that shit. And that is, I basically take this mono track and I drive it into two channels on my desk. I use the Fatso, UAD Fatso. Sorry, here, I'm going to reach for these plugins. And the UAD 1176 Blue Stripe. You're going to see when I play this back that there's a fair amount of compression on the Fatso. That's by design. And a pretty good amount of compression on the 1176. I really just want these two things when the vocal starts to fall off, because every singer will sing hard at first, and then as the line gets longer, you know, they get quieter. The Fatso will smash that down and then start opening up and sort of fill in the back part of the track. So I'm going to show you this plugins here, and then that comes to my desk. There's a little bit of EQ on the desk, and there's a plugin. There's a plugin, literally physical insert plugin chain. Back here, I'll get to that in a second. But you can see the plugins here, and hopefully this is about how they should be driven, hopefully.
She'll dig, dig just a little bit deeper. She's a shake-up snake I'd play for
So
keeper.
If we look at the lead vocal, the 1176, you can see I'm hitting pretty hard. That's by design. I want that sound. I want that 1176 blue stripe sound to do that. The fact, though, if you're looking at it, you're seeing that it's doing 15 to 20 dB of compression. I have the width or the warmth cranked up. So it's basically, I want this to have all the lights on all the time, kind of. And as you can see, it's definitely doing it. And then I blend those two tracks equally back into my desk into two tracks, two channels. So I'm going to solo. This will be the Fatso channel. So this is just the Fatso.
She'll dig, dig just a little bit deeper.
I don't know if you notice there's not a lot of dynamics.
She's a shake-up snake I'd
by design.
Play for keeper.
And then the other channel, the 1176, this one, not as much distortion, because Fatso is generating a pretty good amount of distortion, but its own kind of cool distortion.
She'll dig, dig just a little bit deeper.
And those are exactly at the same level in the desk. Exactly the same level.
She's a shake-up snake I'd play for keeper.
But yet, obviously, one of them sounds a little quieter. So that's because
and
just
don't
the
be
tonal
fooled
characteristics.
She calls you honey.
Part of that reason why they're a little bit different, too, is that behind me here, I have the console inserted. I have an LA-3A, just sort of softly.
She'll dig.
Not that
just
softly,
a little bit.
Sort of softly compressing. And then I have a 500 series Pultec EQP1A, one of the new ones. It's really great. I have a little bit of EQ on that for the vocal, and that's sort of my vocal EQ. Try my best not to have much EQ on the desk. The EQ is on my desk right now, but that's just for the high-pass filters. So when we take that and put him in, the next thing I would do is processing. I'm a huge Tape Echo fan. I have these full tones. They're the best. Anything else, I'm not endorsed or anything, believe me. But I love them. I have a huge box of tapes. I replace tapes about every 2 or 3 weeks. And they sound like this when blended in here.
She'll dig, dig just a little bit deeper.
So that's just two full tones
of
panned
a
little bit.
For keeper.
Here's one of them up really loud.
And don't be fooled if she calls you honey.
And you know, they have a different tone, both of them.
She's loaded, dies, and buried.
I drive them pretty hard, input-wise. And the more you drive them, actually, I'm going to crank these up a little bit, the cooler they get.
She'll dig, dig just a little bit deeper.
Start to get more crunchy. And just drive it even harder.
She's a shake-up snake, I'd play for keeper.
All right, and that's going to cause, it's going to add a little bit of, it's just going to add a little bit of depth to the vocal without using reverb. But don't really, I'm not a big reverb fan.
She'll dig, dig just a little bit deeper. She's a shake-up snake, I'd play for keeper.
Yeah, something like that. And that's probably all I would do to his vocal. I'm pretty confident on this mix I didn't do anything else. I think it's just that. You can see here there is a de-esser. I like this Fab Filter de-esser. There's a little bit of that on the
track.
A little bit of that. And then my good friend George Massenburg, a little bit of EQ. This is something that a little bit of EQ here, this 318. It's a little bit of a peak because of the distortion, because of the amplifier. Next to us on our track here, there's a double, and it's basically one of the takes that we did. There's no double in the chorus, it's only in the verse. So.
No sin, no crime, no evidence anywhere.
Yeah, just a double in the chorus to thicken in the verse to thicken that up. And then there's background vocals. The bass player, Noah Denny's the background vocalist. He's super, super great singer. And I have two tracks we can see here. There's three tracks. One, two, three. And I am bouncing them to a stereo bus. I'm also doing a little bit of echo, some Echo Boy and some UAD, AKG. Kind of doing some processing here. And so I don't really have to go to outboard stuff. I can just do it in here and it recalls fast. So let me find a spot here where there's some sizable amount of background vocals here. There's like three tracks. Oh, now I gotta turn them on.
Leave you to bleed. Dig, dig just a little bit deeper.
You know, pretty rock and roll. And when I put all those in, so, and that's basically the whole song. There's only a couple of little things. We have tambourine, you know, some tambourine, that's no big deal. In the verses, there's a Moog. And I am not a big fan of recording the Moog, just DI, or recording synths or whatever. So for this project, what I wanted to do is I wanted to make sure that everything went through amps. So our overdub amp set up out there. We put the Moog in here. We ran it out into the room. And then afterwards, when I was mixing, I decided, oh, you know, it might be cool to kind of make the Moog kind of crazy sounding. So here's the Moog. And using a couple of my favorite plugins, Valhalla DSP, this is the Freak Echo, which is free. You can just get it for free, and it's brilliant. LA-2A from 1170, from UA, sorry. And of course, Soundtoys Tremolator. The Soundtoys, you can't go wrong with any of their stuff. And you can see that's what's doing this crazy tremolo sort of vibe. So if I back this up just a little bit and unmute here, we're getting close. There's only a couple of things. There's only really two tracks here that we haven't talked about yet. That's just a little bit of the Moog, just to provide some ear candy for you stoners out there on headphones. There's the last part of this is just a bridge guitar solo sort of vibe, and this is Tyler just, you know, tearing it up. That pedal, that's a Spaceman Effects Sputnik pedal. Strangely enough, Sputnik. And sometimes it just peters out while you're playing, and that's exactly what happened. It just sort of gated itself. And just cool track. And that is literally the whole track. There's some turnaround guitars that are kind of happening here. I think they're happening right here. Oh, yeah. Should talk about these. So these are a bunch of stacks. So this was several tracks that I recorded together. We kept stacking up different parts, and then I mixed them together, just mixed them in the computer and printed them. So it's multiple parts. Kind of a cool sound. You know, I'm just gonna turn around. Vocally on this song, it's pretty simple rock vocal, you know, a little bit of distortion, a lot of compression, get a great singer, you know, it's kind of all it takes. Good song. So, everybody and their brother does parallel compressing, it seems like. You know, I have been doing it. I do pretty simple parallel compressing. But then I use, for the two bus, I do not use the SSL. So, they say I don't use it. Sometimes I use it. But on this track, definitely not using it. This is the API 2500 compressor that's on the two bus. In parallel, there are some parallel buses. There is a drum bus that's a Neve, it's over here, 33609. I set the gain into that so that it never does more than about 4 to 5 dB of compression on the meter, which is a fair amount of compression. But to set them up, what I do is I put the fader, like the kick drum fader, at zero, put it at zero on the meter, on the VU meter. And then I add the parallel in so that it does 1 dB of gain on left and right side, just 1 dB of gain. So that's about 4 dB of compression, adds 1 dB of gain at the fader. So there's definitely some gain happening there. If I was to solo the drums and turn off the parallels, you'd hear it. It would sound like this. This is with them on. And here's the 33609 off. And then the second one is the Fatso. So there's the Fatso being off. There's off and on. So it's a small change, but tonally for me, it's a great change. The Fatso is the second one. The 33609 gets kick, snare, toms, and overheads. That's it. Just kick, snare, tom, and overheads. That's all that goes to it. Make sure that's right. Kick, snare, tom, and overheads. Sometimes I put the room in it, but rarely. It just depends on the track. The Fatso gets only drums. So kick, snare, toms. No cymbals. And the Fatso is similar to the setting you saw for the vocal. All buttons, all lights on, and I want the drums to hit that Fatso like super hard. So it's hard to sort of see maybe, but in the camera, if the camera over here can see it, but you know, it's a about 15 dB of compression. And that's part of that cool pumping thing that's happening. And then I just blend that back in. Same exact deal. It provides a lot of compression and it provides a lot of tone, like really cool tone. I have a second 33609. All my music goes to it, minus the bass. So keyboards, guitars. All the keyboards and guitars goes to that. Same exact setup. Put 1K tone up. Put it up in, you know, until it goes to both channels. Get about 40 dB of compression. Sometimes it's less. That one I don't. Sometimes I move the compressor around, but I want about 1 dB of gain. And then same thing on the background, on the lead vocal and background vocals, except I'm using a GML compressor there. Don't ask me to explain how it works. I don't know. Ask George. I know that I found a setting that I like. That's a tiny bit of peak limiting, but mostly it's an RMS compressor. And it, you know, it's 4 or 5 or 6 dB of compression. Again, I have it just add 1 dB of gain. I set those up before I start mixing and never touch them again. I never look at them. I never do anything with them. Everything goes through them all the time. It's just part of the deal. Sometimes, if I feel like that the tracks that have come to me, like if I haven't recorded them, if they come to me and they're too compressed, I'll turn things off. If the guitars are too compressed, I'll take them out of that bus. Same thing with vocals. If they come to me and there something's weird with them and the parallel doesn't make it better, then I'll take them out of those buses. But they're on buses on my desk. So buses 1 and 2 is the 33609, 3, 4 is the Fatso, 5, 6 is the second 33609, and 7, 8 is the 8900. There's a few other buses, but they're a little bit more sprinkled to taste. Couple transient designers I have on buses in case I want to add a little longer snare drum to the mix. I just hit a button, send the snare drum to it, solo it, listen to it, get it the way I sound, and then just blend it into where I hear the change. And that's kind of it. I have a Retro 176 that is in mono on the bass at all times. And that's in parallel. So regardless of what I'm doing in the box, in here, compressor-wise, I'm using the 176. Now, what this setup works for me is that basically, if you've noticed, I don't have a lot of inserts on the console. I do insert a Empirical Labs Distressor and a pair of vintage 550As for the kick and snare. They're not on at the moment, because I just didn't need them for this. But a lot of times when I have tracks coming in that I'm mixing, I'll use those. And I pretty much always use the distressors for kick and snare, almost always. And if I hit play, you'll see the distressors. They're set way too high right now, but they're not in. So again, I recorded this, so I don't really need them, so I have them turned off. But that's a very common setting for me. As far as reverbs and things, I'm not a big reverb fan. I have a PCM-80, I have a PCM-90, and I have a bunch of pedals in loops over here. So I can send a track to these pedal loops back here behind me, and this wall of rack is covered in Velcro, so I can just pull a pedal off, plug it up. I can plug up a chain of pedals and see if something cool happens, and sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. And then behind me, way up there on the top, is a bunch of old Pioneer, Panasonic, and Sansui spring reverbs from hi-fi units. Sometimes those make really great sounds. I also will do this trick. I'll use an aux on the desk, and I'll send it into an input of Pro Tools and use an input in Pro Tools as an aux with a plug-in and use the UAD plate. I actually have a plate. I have an echo plate, but sometimes that plate and sometimes the AKG BX20 really sort of work, plus some of the Valhalla plugins. They just really, really, really sound good. So thanks for listening to me blather on for the last few minutes. If you have questions, you can email me at vance@sputniksound.com. I don't always get back to you right away, but I try my best to get back. Don't ask me big, long questions. I'm working and busy. But if you have a couple of questions, I'll get around to getting to you. If you're ever in Nashville, hit me up. Let's have coffee or a drink. I'm going to play the track back now at a pretty insanely loud volume and just kind of run a little rough mix down here. And I hope you enjoy it. This is Tyler Bryant and The Shakedown, and the song is called Loaded Dice and Buried Money. For reals. For reals, y'all.